The scriptures tell us that there's a worship song in heaven. There's a particular worship song in heaven that occurs from the mouths of 24 elders surrounding the throne of God. And they sing this song, Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. Our Lord and God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power because you have created all things. And by your will, they exist and were created. This song of worship, this song of giving exaltation and glory to the Lord, is due to the fact that there is a God who exists and a God who has created all things, and not only creates all things, but has sustained all things. It becomes ever more present and profound to us that we not only believe that God has created us with a purpose as being image bearers of the living God, but to be even as bold to say, the reason you are breathing air right now, your existence, your ability to be with us and sit amongst people, that is the very gift of the living God, even in this moment. And the scriptures tell us that you exist and are sustained for a particular reason, a particular purpose. And that's to have a relationship with the living God in heaven on earth, your creator, your sustainer. And not only is this a relationship that he offers to you when you discover when you have a relationship with the living God, it is a beautiful, pleasurable thing, is it not? I love how David in his songs, his worship songs, he sought to the best of his human ability to conceive poetically what that kind of pleasure in relationship with the living God is like. I think one of the big reasons David is called the man after God's own heart is that he took the time to think about what it means to be a son or daughter of the living God. I think he processed through it. As I get older, I'm falling in love more with poetry as I get older, as time goes on. Because I realize that in order for you to write poems, you actually have to know what you're talking about. You can't just blather along something just because it rhymes. I find that when people use the art of words in poetry, it's because they have experienced that and have suffered through that, have lived through that. And they're able to articulate in such an artistic way through the language of words what that life is like. David does this. This is why the Psalms are so beautiful. I just want to read Psalm 8. Psalm 8 is David encountering the pleasurable, beautiful relationship of the living God. Yahweh, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. You've covered, like a blanket, your heavens with your majesty. From the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have established a stronghold on account of your adversaries in order to silence the enemy and the avenger. What is he saying? Through the existence and sustaining of children, the avenger cannot survive. When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you set into place, what is a human being that you remember him? A son of man that you look after him. You made him little less than God and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet. All the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the wild, the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea that pass through the currents of the seas, Lord, Yahweh, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. To me, I look at that psalm and it's romantic. It's romantic in the sense of David wanting to use all of his being to proclaim how majestic and how beautiful his God is. And this relationship of man with God, particularly with you as a believer with God, is likened, all throughout the scriptures, is likened to a covenantal marriage relationship. First represented through the nation of Israel, through the Old Testament, and continuing on into the church. What is another word for the church that we know from the scriptures? You are the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. And I know for every single one of us that is in a marriage relationship or has been in a marriage relationship before, we know without a doubt every relationship is based upon, the foundation practically of a good relationship is communication. You don't communicate with your spouse, that vine is slowly going to rot and fester and die. And it's kind of wild to think about marriage these days, how it is deformed and conformed into the world's perspective of what marriage is, of a covenantal relationship between a man and a woman. And you realize that in order to have a true covenantal relationship, you must have the ability to communicate with one another. That's why you can't get married to a tree. That's why you can't get married to yourself. And I give those two examples is because people have done them. March 26, 2018, ABC News sends an article. Woman marries 100-year-old tree in hopes of saving it from being cut down. And her response to this is, I'm just having fun with something very serious, said bride who wed a tree. Can I tell you something, friends? You cannot have a true relationship with an abstraction. You cannot have a true relationship with an inanimate object. You cannot have an identity midlife crisis, end up borrowing or buying a brand new Corvette and assume I'm going to find sustenance, sustainment, fulfillment. Why? You can talk to that car all you want. It's not going to talk to you back. This is something important in relationship with the living God. People who are skeptical about having a relationship with God or skeptical even in the existence of God, one of the primary things that I can tell them that I know without a doubt, but they cannot possibly understand, is this. I know I have a relationship with God. Why? Because I speak to Him every day and He speaks to me. That's what our relationship is based upon. The fact that I know that God is not some abstraction, force, philosophy, moral value or system, just a particular worldview, is because I speak to Him and out of His Word and out of His Spirit, He speaks to me. Call me crazy, I don't care. That is why I know and believe that the Scriptures proclaim God is not a force, God is a person. God, as John Frame, who wrote The Doctrine of the Knowledge of God, how we discover that we have knowledge of the living God as human beings, says, God is not a vague abstract principle of force, but a living person. I would be as bold to say, person is intentional. Being is not just enough. Person who fellowships with His people. And like any relationship, God has instituted this instrument of language, what I'm doing right now, through the inflection of my lungs to my diaphragm, to the moving of my tongue and my lips and my mouth, I am uttering sounds that you guys understand to be words. That's kind of wild. And that is a creation of the living God. He breathes life into Adam, and Adam speaks to him. He gives us this ability to articulate who we are and where we come from, and people who know our English language and the many diverse languages that are all over the world are able to communicate with one another. But with any relationship, we discover, you know, I can ask any married couple in this room, you know, tell me the story of how you guys met. And what you'll discover is one person talked to the other person first. Right? Right? Hannah was the one who talked to me first. Do you remember that? She introduced herself to me. She's a firecracker that way. And what's amazing about the relationship of God is there is never a point where you initiate the conversation with God as a human being. God has always initiated the conversation first. Like any relationship, God is the one who has instituted the instrument of language to interact with him. And he is always the one who speaks first. And he is always the one who's going to speak last. You test the scriptures by looking at that, right? You go to God speaking to Adam. Who's speaking first? God. You have God speaking to Abraham. Who's speaking first? God. You have God speaking to Isaac, Jacob, Moses, the prophets, Joseph, Mary, Zechariah, the apostles. It's God who steps up and says, "This is who I am. Come and follow me." It is God who is the better communicator, is he not? It is God who is the leader of the relationship, is he not? And this is why it's so interesting to me that I find experientially in dark seasons of my soul is the very first thing that I ask is, "God, where are you? I can't hear you." Because I believe the lie that God is busy doing something else. Instead of speaking to me. I love what Eugene Peterson says, that whenever we enter into prayer, whenever we begin with praying, we're entering into already a middle of a conversation that God is having with you. He is already speaking. You are simply responding. It is God. If he is the better communicator, if he is the leader of the relationship between he and you, and if it's God who are both of these things, then it should be God who is going to determine the rules and structures of how this relationship pans out, right? And you know what? When we begin to submit to that reality, it's God who determines how this relationship is going to go with the bride of Christ, the nation of Israel, all the way trickle down to little old you in the room. If we realize that it's God who is the initiator, the worker, and the rule maker of this relationship, I find absolute freedom in that. Freedom in that. That's so freeing, right? It's not up to you to determine your relationship with the living God. God has given you all that you need to know what's required of you in having this covenantal marriage relationship. He gives you all that we need in order to have a relationship with him. And even more than that, he gives us himself. And he gives us his way. And here comes to the big idea of chapter 5, at least in my mind. I believe this. That when we not only know God, number one, but we know what God wants from us, our lives are going to become happier lives. If we know God and we know what God wants from us, our lives are going to become happier, more satisfactory lives. And the reason I believe this is true is discovered here in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Let's look at the first section together. Guard your steps when you go to the house of God. Better to approach in obedience than to offer the sacrifices fools do, for they ignorantly do wrong. Do not be hasty to speak. Do not be impulsive to make a speech before God. God is in heaven and you are on earth. so let your words be few. Some of us need that tattooed on our chests. Just as dreams accompany much labor, so also a fool's voice comes with many words. When you make a vow to God, don't delay fulfilling it, because he does not delight in fools. Fulfill what you vow. Better that you do not vow than that you vow and do not fulfill it. Do not let your mouth bring guilt on you, and do not say in the presence of the messenger that it was a mistake. That's an excuse even my kids use. Why should God be angry with your words and destroy the work of your hands? For many dreams bring futility, so do many words. Therefore, fear God. Solomon, in this text, is sharing the protocol of communication and worship to God, particularly when you make vows to him, promises to him. I would be even as bold to say that you weren't the first one to make a promise or a vow to God. God has made a promise to you. Remember the story of Abraham. Abraham was just plugging along when all of a sudden God showed up. Said, everyone, just drop what you're doing, gather your family, and go to the land that I will tell you. And you discover that there's this thing called the Abrahamic covenant, which is, I'm going to make you a nation out of you, where your descendants will outnumber the stars in the sky and the sand upon the seashore. And this nation will bless every other nation on earth because of the Messiah that's going to come out of your loins. But in order to have relationship with me, there needs to be some rules. And Solomon shares this protocol of communication and worship to God. And notice what he does here. He uses the example of a fool who interacts with the living God. Praise God that there's a God in heaven who is willing to interact with fools. I say amen to that. Let me just go down a list of what he's saying here. There's seven of them, at least that I have found in this section of Scripture. Fools offer sacrifices ignorantly, and they act ignorantly to the desires of God. Ignorance. Fools are hasty to speak. Fools are impulsive or assumptive. Fools speak many words. Fools delay, or they simply recant their promises to God. Fools bring guilt upon themselves through their own mouths. They stick their foot in their mouth. Fools' dreams die because of the many words they share. And now, friends, a natural reaction to these seven works of a fool is to look at these things and say, I've done that, I've done that, I've done that, I've done that, I've done that. And maybe you ask the question, do I really do those things? Or when have I done these things? And listen, there's a benefit to that in an application-wise to the Scriptures. But if you're anything like me in my flesh, my natural reaction to this is, well, then what's the point? I can't keep up with all these rules. There's 616 laws that God demands of the nation of Israel. I can't do that. I can't accomplish that. A good question to ask that Ecclesiastes helps with is, how do I become someone that's not a fool, right? How do I not become a fool? I think about this, like, what is the opposite of a foolish person? Yeah, wise, right? That's our natural response to that. I think if before we approached Ecclesiastes, we would definitely say, a wise man is the opposite of a foolish man. But I also think Ecclesiastes has shattered that presupposition. Because we've discovered that there's limitations to man's wisdom, is there not? There's questions that Koheleth is asking in Ecclesiastes that he does not have the answer for, friends. There's a limitation to that wisdom. And God cares about that enough to say, I want to reveal to you these answers, but you need to follow me. If you're not, you become a foolish person. Ecclesiastes has questions that we cannot answer through the limitations of our wisdom. Does that make us fools? No, only if we're not paying attention. And the reality is this, that if we were wise, and we're looking at this text, what we're discovering is that God is imparting a wisdom that is not like man's at all. This is relationship of God to man. I can be wise practically in my relationship with my spouse, the relationship with my children, and my relationship with other human beings. The moment it becomes a human having a relationship with the living God, I have nothing apart of wisdom to be able to offer. I don't even know where to start. So the reality is this, my friends, that in a relationship of man to God, if we think we know how to approach the living God with our own power, wisdom, and strength, you know what that definition is? It's a fool. And so you're asking, Pastor Conor, what do you think then is the opposite of this foolishness? And here is what I believe is not only the opposite, but it is the antidote that can be found in Ecclesiastes 5. The answer that I believe that answers all of these seven foolish moves, that can cover all of these foolish moves into one posture, and that is the posture of humility. And that, in many ways, is not a fun posture to have. You might ask the question, Pastor Conor, what is humility? What wrongly attributed to C.S. Lewis is this kind of pithy saying, humility is not thinking less of yourself, it is thinking of yourself less. Does that sound good? Sounds good to me. I mean, that's a motivational poster in my office, you know, like, that's a wonderful thinking. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, it is thinking of yourself less. But what's the problem with that saying? If that's the definition of humility, that means I can accomplish humility completely devoid of the relationship of God in my life. I know it's not attributed to Lewis, but whoever wrote that, I know it's big amongst Christian circles. I don't imagine that that was their intention or desire, but I see that, and I see that's devoid of God. I just need to think less of myself. That's all it takes. I think that's a part of it. I think humility is a posture and a devotion of life that cannot be disconnected from the very presence of the living God. Why? Because it begins first with us and God, and then it turns to us and others, right? I truly believe that, you know, Jesus, he was called Emmanuel, which means what? God with us, right? I think a response to that title of Emmanuel is humility, which is the answer, us with God. It's this submissiveness to God. It's an awareness of God in everywhere I go, everything that I do, all that I say. It's God who has the first say in where I go and how I lead my life. Humility declares that your life and my life has this primary relationship, and everything else is subsequent relationships. Thomas Aquinas calls humility submissiveness to God and the moderation of my own ambition to serve God better. Martin Luther calls humility joyful acceptance of God's will. A. Rischel says humility is the unconditional dependence upon God for my life. A new book that came out by Dr. Joel Mudamale, who I like a lot, he wrote this book called The Hidden Peace, and it's about humility. The Hidden Peace. And he says, humility is an awareness of who God is, which defines who we are and allows us rightly to relate to other people. I love that. Because what he's saying is the side effect of our sensitivity to the living God is we discover a life more pleasurable following what he wants us to do rather than following what I want to do. As a response to that, we ask, like, God, you've given us this life. You've created us. Not only have you created us, you are sustaining us right now. You've given us even the competency of complex thought to process and think through your word right here and right now. And you're telling us now to be humble and simply be aware of your presence. That's all that you're asking of us here and now in this moment. And I think in context of Ecclesiastes 5, yes, that's the antidote to the foolishness. Because if I'm truly aware of God and I truly want to please Him, I'm going to guard my steps when I walk into the house of the Lord. When I wake up every morning, wake up next to my wife, you know one thing that doesn't happen? I turn over to her and I never say this, "All right, Hannah, what are the rules for our relationship today? What do I need to know to how this goes on?" And even more so, same sort of thing. She'll turn around and she'll say, "All right, Conor, what are the rules of our relationship today? What's changed from yesterday to now today?" Can I be as bold to say that's somehow how we treat God? We become so like afraid I'm afraid that anything that I do is only going to be wrong. He's not going to be pleased with me. I'm going to make some sort of ignorant step and He's going to be angry with me. He's going to condemn me. If God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, that means His word will be the same yesterday, today, and forever. And your relationship with Him will be the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the only thing that you need to be aware about is the sensitivity of the Spirit to lead you into paths of righteousness for His namesake, not your own. And you'll discover that even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil. Why? Because the presence of the living God is with you. Never leave you nor forsake you. Because of the grace of Jesus. Now you might be as bold to say, "Well, like, Pastor Conor, give me an example." I'll give you the best example. God, in His pleasure of creating us and building us up, says, "Not only will I teach you humility, I will show you humility." And He sends His only Son to be the perfect example of humility. And Paul tells us, this is what your life is called to be. You need to adopt the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus, who, existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be exploited. Instead, He emptied Himself by assuming the form of a servant, taking on the likeness of humanity. And when He had come as a man, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. And for this reason, God has highly exalted Him and given Him the name that is above every other name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Some of us have been given a false gospel to proclaim that if you have a relationship with God, that it begins with your glorification above and beyond all that you could ever ask or think. And we normally default to say that glorification is monetary wealth, health, reputation, success. And God says, no, the glory that I have to impart is so much more eternal than that. But if you want that, you need to walk like Jesus walked, where He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on the cross. This awareness, this humility, this awareness and submission to God and all things becomes the precedent of how I live. If Joel Mutamali's book, The Hidden Peace, is correct, that definition is correct, then if I keep the relationship with my God primary, then all my other relationships are going to have its right priority. And not only that, it brings that which brings me pleasure in the temporary things of this life, the wealth, the possessions, it brings all of that into right order also. And this is how he continues. We don't have the time now to look at verses 8 through 20 all the way. But he says, there are those who rule, not like Jesus, who has humbled Himself and been obedient even to the point of death. But if you look at verse 8, He sees oppression, poor, perversion of justice, righteousness in the promise, in the province, and he says, don't be astonished at the situation. Why? Because they are of the kingdom of death, not the kingdom of life. Because one official protects another official, and higher officials protect them, and the profit of the land is taken by all, and the king is served by the field, and the one who loves silver is never satisfied with silver. Why? Because his primary relationship is silver, not God. And it becomes futile. You know, I look at that, and I find it very interesting that he's talking about the corruption of rulers in high places. And Solomon is a king. He's a ruler in this world. And he's saying, hey, I get it. I am seeing all of this. That this wisdom concerning the reality of Solomon's position as ruler over Israel, he is not blind to the fact that a ruler offers protection and a transaction that the people will give him riches. He says, I will offer you protection. You give me back your children, your food, and all of that. I'm going to tax you. I'm going to make your sons soldiers. I'm going to make your daughters concubines. And that's just the way that the world works. And we are as blatant to say, who is God and does he really care for me? There is humility that can be found in a true relationship with the living God. I truly believe that the Lord in heaven is the best. I'm going to say this, it might sound brash. He's the best tyrant you can ever have. And in closing, I'm just going to say this. Like, we saw a historical moment yesterday. And I felt the temptation to just involve the entire afternoon into looking at it, watching what was happening from different angles. And the only word that I can come to, at least in the conclusion of that, is sickness. There's a sickness. Our nation is sick. And within hours on social media, I'm sure you guys saw it, it seemed like every leader, pastor, influencer had an opinion on the subject. And there is a need, absolutely, for wisdom in times like this. People are asking for wisdom in times like this. Unbelievers are asking you for wisdom in times like this. But I've discovered once again that God is my king and that he is a better avenger against man than others can be. The response to the event yesterday is not another political strategy. The response to what happened yesterday is not violence. It's the word of God, and it's the obedience to his word. I want to end with this. The same writer of Ecclesiastes, Solomon, he built a temple for the living God to bring his presence amongst the people. It was built, it was dedicated, and it was opened with the precise specifications that God had given Solomon. You understand that? It didn't come out of Solomon's artistic ability or wisdom. It came from a simple instruction from the living God, say, this is what I want, and this is what I want you to do. And Solomon did it. And when it was finished, it said the glory of God was so much that people couldn't even enter in. And when it was finished, they waited. And God spoke, and this is what he said. Then Yahweh appeared to Solomon at night and said to him, I have heard your prayer, and I've chosen this place for myself as a temple of sacrifice. I shut the sky so there is no rain. I command the grasshopper to consume the land. I send pestilence on my people. and my people who bear my name, if they would do what? If they would humble themselves, pray, and seek my face, turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. That is our answer. But listen, the USA is not God's people. The church is. We are God's people. So you know what? What happened yesterday is not a political event. And this is not a political issue. This is a church issue in our nation. And we are called, the church is called, to humble ourselves, to repent of our sin, and to ask the Lord that he would heal our land. We know unbelievers aren't going to do it. We know government authorities aren't going to do it. It's time for the church to repent of their sin, to humble themselves, and to seek his face. Let's pray together.